Friends, in this video we would discuss about the impact of GST on startups and small and medium sized businesses. Small and medium sized businesses are the backbone of the Indian economy, and it is very important to understand and discuss how GST can impact them. Let's first discuss about the positive impact on startups and SMEs. So one of the most positive impact is it will enable ease of starting businesses. Today, a business having operations across different states need VAT registration in different states. So different tax rules applies in different states, which adds to complication and incur higher compliance cost. GST would enable centralized registration and would make sure that there is uniformity in terms of rates of goods and the rules within a state compared to the other states. This will really help small businesses to start their business quickly. The second positive impact would be market expansion. As of now, SMEs do restrict themselves to a state because they know that if they need to sell or render services to a different state, they again need to register themselves under GST. And then there are different complications when you render services or sell goods to different state. Under GST, these all laws will get nullified because there will be standard one law irrespective of location of buyer and seller. This will allow SME segment to expand and reach their new customers across borders. This is called One India, One Tax. And the third point is reduction of tax burden on new business. So as per the current tax structure, businesses with a turnover of more than 5 lakhs need to register and pay VAT. Now that basic exemption under GST has been enhanced to 20 lakhs and 10 lakhs for special states, which is a big relief to large number of small dealers and traders. So if your taxable supply, total taxable supply is less than 20 lakhs and 10 lakhs for states like Northeast, Himachal and Jammu Kashmir, then you really not need to register under GST. There are other provisions which will determine whether you need to register or not. Then elimination, this is very, very important. The fourth point relates to elimination of distinction between goods and service tax. So basically under GST, there is no distinction between goods and services. So this will simplify various legal proceedings because until now, there were many goods or services wherein both the VAT and service tax were levied. For example, software goods, sale of software. Now with the GST, there is no distinction. So goods and services are treated on a same way. So there is no chance where on a same good or services, both VAT or service tax can be levied. And this will really help to reduce tax evasion also, and will be a level playing field. The fifth point, which is also very important, is that under GST, there is no entry tax now. So entry tax is also getting subsumed into GST. So there is no entry tax. And once goods are manufactured or sold any part of India, since there is no entry tax, there will be reduction in the logistic cost because there will be no toll checks and interstate point check. As per a special report, the logistic costing might reduce to about 20% to at least 20% from a current level. This will really boost e-commerce across the nation. Sixth point is removal of multiple taxation. Now with GST coming in, transfer of goods and services, this will reduce the cost of doing business as there will be no cascading taxation. So there is no tax on tax. For example, earlier there was VAT on excise also. Now that is not there. So these are the points which we discussed, which will have positive impact on startups, SMEs and MSMEs in starting and doing their businesses. Now, there are some serious issues also under GST which might impact negatively on startups and SMEs. The first thing is with relates to registration. Under GST, every supplier of goods and service tax needs to register if their turnover in a financial year exceeds 20 lakhs. So many people would think that smaller businesses are not required to register under GST. However, the catch is that if you supply or render services or supply of goods or supply of services from one state to other state, then registration is mandatory. So if you are supplying services or supplying goods from Gurgaon to Delhi, you have to register under the GST. This is the same provision when earlier if you are supplying goods from one state to other, then you have to register under CST. Is the concept of casual taxable person. Now this means that one who occasionally undertakes transactions and as whether as a principal or agent in any other capacity need to register where he has no fixed place of business. So there may be many scenarios wherein they are interior decorators or there are casual or they are housewives or there are freelancers who take one of the assignments on a project basis. Now if they do not have fixed place of business, then they have to register under GST as a casual taxable person. And there is in this scenario the 20 lakh limit is not there. So if you do not have a fixed place of business, you still have to register under GST. This is very harsh on freelancers and one of the project takers. The third is composition levy mechanism is very restrictive. Even though composition mechanism is a system wherein if your taxable supply is up to 50 lakhs, and then you do not need to register. If you if you as a manufacturer ready to pay 2.5% taxes on the value, or as a dealer 1.1%. But the problem is that someone who is taking up a composition levy mechanism system cannot sell on e-marketplace, because for an e-marketplace you need to mandatorily register under GST. So there are many small businesses now who supply goods or services on e-marketplace or on e-commerce like Amazon and Flipkart. If you do that, and if you do it for 1 rupee, you have to mandatorily register under the GST. The fourth point relates to reverse charge mechanism. Now in this scenario, since up to 20 lakh rupees of taxable supply, there is no need to register. So if you are doing business with an unregistered dealer, then there is a reverse charge which is applicable. So the buyer needs to pay GST on the value and also need to self raise invoices. So for example, Mr. A, which is not a registered dealer, sell goods to Mr. B, who is a registered dealer. Mr. B needs to pay reverse charge, GST reverse charge on that goods or services, and also self raise that invoices. This is very, very, very harsh on small businesses. The fifth point is also very, very critical, and I was reading an article also some time back wherein it said that in the interiors of India, the internet penetration is still very low and the technology challenge is there. So small businesses, when they do not have the technical expertise, they would face problem while migrating to GST. Another problem is working capital blockage. So since funds are required to be maintained in the form of electronic credit ledger with the tax department, it will lead to liquidity crunch. Also, input tax credit mechanism wherein you will not get input till the time the other person pay off the liability, it might lead to working capital blockage. Let's also discuss about the mechanism of input tax credit, which is point number 7 in our video. Input tax credit, that is ITC, is available to buyer only if supplier had paid taxes inside a given window. For example, if Mr. A buys goods from Mr. B and Mr. B collects taxes on that, and if Mr. B do not pay the tax which is collected, then Mr. A will not get the input on that. So it has got serious penal provisions also. So which is a reasonable percentage of small businesses which will face this life cycle? The intent may not be to evade for those businesses. At times, for small businesses, when they are under the working capital crunch, they have to decide between paying salary to the workers on time or to pay taxes to the government on time. I know many businesses who regularly in the current regime pay interest on VAT or service tax just to pay off other liabilities on time, because they know that they can still pay interest and can pay off their government liability. Now that option will not be there in the GST. The eighth point relates to compliance rating. This is very interesting. So the system will give a compliance rating and it will be a public rating. So before you enter into a business with someone, you know whether that person, how that person is rated on the system. And if that person is not rated good on the system, you might want to avoid in doing business with that person. So everyone would want to avoid the poor rating, and they will be forced to pay off the liability within the time, will be forced to pay. This is good. I mean, the intention of the government is good, but the problem will be the migration, the transition period, maybe for the next 15 to 18 months, when the small businesses might have to work very hard on the working capital management, because now they need to pay off the liability and file returns. They also need to find out a system to set up a system for GST compliances. And another point is added compliances for exports. So there are hundreds of startups, SMEs who earn revenue by exporting their services, mostly in the technology sector. Now with GST, they have to mandatorily register and file returns. And even though they have an option to claim refunds of input taxes, so they have to file at least 36 to 37 returns annually, and they can claim inputs. So in my view, to conclude, GST will bring in a structured business environment, will make doing business easy. They will bring a level playing field between the bigger business and smaller business. But initially, in the next 18 months, 15 to 18 months, since small businesses do not have the infrastructure, neither the training to comply with GST, this will be little harsh on small businesses to start with, and in my view, any change will bring disruption. So small businesses have to be very careful initially. They have to have a system to get the compliances done, to maintain the working capital, so they can continue to render services and do good businesses. Thanks for this video. Do let me know if you have any views, feedback, comments on this video. Call us, email us, and we will be more than happy to answer any of your queries. Thank you.